Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Pereira. Looking to up investments and encourage companies to make in India, Commerce and Industry Minister Suresh Prabhu on Tuesday held a meeting with the Invest India team. Invest India is the official investment promotion and facilitation agency of the government. At the meeting, Prabhu, who assumed charge of the ministry on Monday, deliberated on how to promote investments in the country. Prabhu called for a paradigm shift in approach for enhancing investments. This, Prabhu said, should be in line with the idea of rolling out red carpet for investors. The minister also called for setting up a war room to ensure that investment proposals materialize and are not held up due to hurdles. On this edition of The Big Picture, we will analyze if a war room on investments can spur economic growth. Joining me on the program today are Nitin Desai, former Chief Economic Advisor, Government of India; S.K. Jindal, Chairman, Investment and Capital Markets, ASSOCHAM; and Yatish Rajawat, Senior Journalist. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. Mr. Jindal, I'd like to begin with you. What do you think of a war room as far as investments are concerned? Is it a good idea?
It's a very good idea. As I look at three ministers, all are focusing on now the missing things like investment and generating employment and exports as well. It was also lagging behind. So I find that when these three successful people focus on this particular aspect of the thing which was lagging behind. In the last 3 years, we were talking about it all the time, that why jobs are not being created, why we don't see it happening, etc., why investments are not coming in, and why exports are going down. So there were various reasons, but when we focus on them, we are always able to find good solutions when we deliberate, when we work upon it, when we discuss upon it. And now I see with these statements coming out from these three ministers, Mr. Suresh Prabhu and Mr. Pradhan also has mentioned, and Mr. Gangwar also, that labor laws, etc., whatever is necessary to create more jobs, that ecosystem will be created, and they are much more focused now. So now the scaling, the actual thing happening will happen now, as I look at. So I believe that this is a very good step, and their focus is right on the dot, what is required for the industry now.
Okay. Mr. Desai, I'd like to bring you into the picture now. We've got a new Commerce and Industry Minister taking charge. He's taken charge on Monday. What do you believe his biggest challenges are going to be going ahead?
I would say his biggest challenge is going to be basically reviving the processes of industrial investment and accelerating export growth, because that has not happened so far. On the specific things that he talked about in the statement on foreign investment, I think his language of paradigm shift is very necessary, because we've had foreign direct investment coming in. If you look at the numbers, if I leave portfolio investment to one side and focus more on foreign direct investment, the problem partly is some of it is in, a lot of it is actually directed at catching the Indian market. For instance, a lot of the stuff which is coming into the e-marketing side is basically oriented at essentially the competition for market share within India. There's a lot of stuff which is coming in on brownfield investments, you know, people coming in, buying up stuff which is already there, like, you know, the Japanese buying up some of the pharmaceutical companies and so on. Now, that does not add either to very much to jobs or significantly to technological capacity or more broadly design capacity and so on, which is what happened in other places which got foreign direct investment for manufacturing. So I think he's right to talk of a paradigm shift. How soon can he get it is a different story. Because, you know, how can I enthuse foreign investors when my own companies are not enthusiastic? When my own companies are not enthusiastic about investment, what do I sell to the foreign investor in terms of coming here? Can I talk in terms of make in India, for not just for India, but for the world? Well, unfortunately, world trade is not expanding at the rate at which it was when China had its boom. So he has a difficult job ahead of him.
And also the world is showing a protectionist trend.
So it is showing a protectionist trend. May I suggest to Mr. Prabhu, who's a wonderful man, he's a very good man, he's a person who's done good work throughout whenever he's held a ministerial position, not just now but earlier. So one looks forward to very good out policies from him. What I would say is a key part that he should start looking at is the small and medium sector. And this is something which I think can provide an important point of intervention which could accelerate.
Sure.
Not just industrial growth, but also find ways of connecting foreign capital with India. So the startup program, infrastructure for small industries. Please, I hope they don't come up with silly concessions, but focus on infrastructure. Focus on making business life easier
right.
for the small. Allow them to grow, you know, remove barriers to their growth and so on. So I hope he does that and I look forward to it. But his talk of a paradigm shift is welcome. It's very necessary.
Okay, paradigm shift is welcome. It's very necessary. And what kind of a paradigm shift you're going to see remains to be seen in the next few days. We'll probably get to know. But, you know, interestingly, Mr. Desai brought up investment. And at a time when, you know, private investment is at an all-time low, is the onus now on the government then to, you know, to try and invest further? What is the modus that we should really look to operate on right now?
See, there are two trends happening. One is investment per se. A lot of industries which had borrowed heavily during the 2008-2010 period, that capacity has not come to bear. I mean, demand is still lagging behind that capacity. But like, for instance, in tires, or if you see in automobiles, that capacity is now reaching 98-100%. So their new capacity is being added. But, you know, one of the things that I hope Mr. Prabhu addresses is, you know, delinking this pure investment number of value to labor intensive jobs being created. You see, 100 XYZ company comes into the country, says we are going to invest $1 billion in this country. Where does this $1 billion go? It goes into an automated plant somewhere in the periphery of Delhi, which employs 20 people, but has an investment of $300 million in the land, $400 million in the automated robots, and employs 20 people. And it says, and the rest of the investment goes into the dealership and the trade promotion and all. All this counts as an investment. And there are these companies, I mean, all the mobile companies that have come into the country, they have not produced any labor jobs. Mm. They have produced because one, they're assembly units. Second, they've used automation heavily. So when we think about investment, we need to think about investment not from the point of view, is it $1 billion or is it $1 million? We need to look at it that with this $1 million that this company is putting, how many direct jobs are going to be created on the ground? Mm. And this is how world over governments look at investment. They don't look at the quantum of investment. They look at the quantum of jobs that has been created. So that's one paradigm that Suresh Prabhu has to change within this government, that please don't get fooled by these large numbers, but look at the number of jobs being created. Mm. Second is need to look at industries that are labor intensive, which need this investment. I mean, we don't need another investment in a making a SEZ available somewhere. We don't need that. We don't need because that's just investment to land. What are the 10 big industries that are labor intensive, which India can create over the next 20 years? We never think like that. Hmm. China thinks like that. Which are the next 10 industries that will come up, can be created now for the next 20 years? Third thing is that once you created that, what is the enabling factors needed, as Mr. Desai was pointing out, at district level and state level? Gone are the days that, you know, a company or a industry can be created with what are the incentives that the central government can offer it. Those days are gone. I mean, it's almost the same the world over. What is the differentiation is what happens at a city or district level. You see, if Detroit is able to attract $1 billion of investment from Mahindra and Mahindra, why couldn't Chennai attract it? Why couldn't Pondicherry attract it? The reason is, what was the reason for that? Because
Made in India is not happening in India alone. There's a made in Germany happening. There's a made in France happening. Trump is talking about America first. So all the countries, all the continents that used to talk about free trade and global trade have all become closed.
Sure.
The Chinese and the Indians are talking about free trade.
Hmm.
That paradigm has changed, you know?
Sure. Yeah. Sure. So, Mr. Jindal, ease of doing business, we are ranked at 130 at the moment, I think. You know, the Prime Minister has time and again said that we want to be in the top 50 as far as one of the easiest countries to do business is concerned. Are we seeing any headway as far as ease of doing business is concerned?
Very crucial and very high time now that it should happen, though conceived, announced, etc. But we haven't seen much action there. This is the point which is working like a bottleneck now, that ease of doing business is must for us to get competitive and efficient and then to survive. And that will give us the possibility to create jobs also. Everything, lot of it is focused, lot of it is dependent on ease of doing business. Similarly, labor reforms, for example, for ease of doing business, labor reforms also needs to be that is also high time that they should be done now. Big ticket reforms on labor side, which are mutually beneficial for both sides, conducive, and in the interest of both sides. I am not saying that we should compromise on labor security or safety or anything. No, both sides should be covered, but we should discuss and come out with, we can follow the China model in this very well, because our requirements, our needs and our strengths are similar to China, labor extensive. So we can do follow that model, which is successful model. Labor there works more than 12 hours. They work 8-9 months in the city and then they go back to their homes for 3 months. This model is working very well there. The same skilled labor is always available to the same industry. So it is good for both of them. So that is one thing. That legislation which comes in the way of generating jobs should also be handled well. So these things will only make us competitive, efficient and survivable, and they will bring the growth.
Sure, sure. Yeah, you know, Mr. Desai, as far as investments are concerned, we've all been speaking about, you know, foreign direct investment. What about investment from within India itself? Are we doing anything on that front?
No, this is, I think, frankly, the people don't know why it is being held back. I could say partly it is because you are really seeing a slowdown in demand growth. Anybody who is now involved at the corporate sector, you talk to them and you'll see that basically capacity utilization in the larger sector is around 70-75%. Neither the small sector has been heavily hit by demonetization and also by GST. And I think that loss of employment there, why is it that you're getting a boom in automobile sales but not in FMCG?
Hmm.
That difference, you must understand. That basically we can't grow. Companies are not going to invest unless there's demand growth. And I think jobs, as was being said, jobs is crucial. You know, today, when an Indian company wants to make a public relations statement in the United States, it does not say we are investing so much money in the United States. It says we are going to create so many American jobs.
Hmm.
You know, that's the statement they will make, you know. They will not make a statement about the amount of money. So as Mr. Rajawat was saying, I think we should also change our metric. Say that when we want to do this, start saying what are the jobs that you will create, and of course have a well-defined way of measuring that. The other point, the China example was mentioned. One big difference is China had a workforce which was healthier and better educated. I today have a school system which does not produce people who can read. How are you going to train if they cannot read a manual? So we have a hard job ahead of us in terms of skill training in order to ensure that when the jobs are created, there are people who can actually do those jobs who are available. And incidentally, much of that has to be in the northern states, which is where a large number of people are being added to the workforce. So I'd say that, yes, I think we cannot talk about promoting foreign investment unless we also ask ourselves why domestic investment is not picking up.
Indeed. Ajay Dua, former Secretary, Ministry of Commerce and Industry, joins us on the program at the moment. You know, Mr. Dua, what needs to be done to spur economic growth? Why isn't the investment coming from within the country itself? Why are we focusing so much on foreign direct investment?
I would tend to agree with you fully. I think the role of foreign investment in the Indian overall capital formation has invariably been very small. What we need to be, while all investment is welcome, particularly at a time when the domestic investment has slowed down, the fact of the matter is that we continue to have issues pertaining to aggregate demand being low, hence industry, and there being excess capacity available, and on top of it, now this, wherever there is some demand being created, finding those so-called twin balance sheet problems of the banks and the profitability, etc. But having said that, I think what we need to be addressing now are the, while singular ministries like the Ministry of Commerce, Industry, attend to the issues which fall within their domain, a lot more has to be done by the everybody in the system, particularly those concerned with the economy, that unless we get the macro parameters right, we would not be able to see manufacturing pick up. As we know, we've in quarter one, we've seen a manufacturing growth of 1.2%, the lowest in 20 quarters, 5 years, and that is because of some macro issues, some individual issues. Certainly things like so-called expression which the new minister used yesterday of setting up a war room, probably he doesn't mean physically creating one like a cabinet room or some such thing like we had during the Second World War in Britain, but he probably is drawing attention to the priority which he is going to be giving to investment. Yes, issues which fall within the purview of the industry ministry.
Sure.
So he could be attending. But the macro issues are equally important, if not more important, and I would like to see those being addressed. And there I get to the point of saying, how do we spur private investment in the country? Is it because of some uncertainty which has been brought into the system with, you know, more recently GST, which is good for the long run, but certainly the immediate impact is slowdown, demonetization. The Reserve Bank report says it now all. We know that what adverse impact it has on the economy. The going forward, let's be optimistic, certainly. But I would like to say optimism cannot be without, you know, follow-up or without the larger issues which we need to attend to.
Fair enough. You know, Yatish Rajawat, is the impact of demonetization and GST waning? Because there's a Morgan Stanley report today which says that India may clock a 6.7% growth this fiscal. After the weak April to June quarter, which was at 5.7%, Morgan Stanley is now saying that India, the fiscal could close at 6.7%. So that's clearly a sign that the effects of demonetization and GST are going to wane in the days to come.
You know that, you know, in the last 2 months that GST has come into being, there was an inventory kind of overhaul that happened in the month of April, May, because all the old stock that was there in the supply chain, corporates tried to push it into the retail end. Therefore, manufacturing in June and July became that much less, which has had an impact on manufacturing per se. So I do see that waning now, because now the supply chain is more or less empty, so to say, and capacity is going to be again be deployed more effectively and efficiently and fully in the months ahead. So the fallback or slowdown that we have witnessed in the last almost 6 months, first because of the demonetization and then because of GST, I think we've kind of reached the lowest end of the trough. So that is why, you know, most analysts and most research companies everywhere in the country are saying that we're at the bottom of the trough and there's nothing else but to look upwards now. So the next 7-8 months, I feel that there is going to be a massive push, demand pull, actually, not push, demand pull in the market, and manufacturing is going to take off rapidly.
Okay, manufacturing is going to take off rapidly in the days to come is what you're suggesting. Okay, now looking ahead, Mr. Jindal, what are the sectors that we need to focus on in the days to come or in the quarters to come?
One thing that's they are talking about FDI relaxation in and construction and print media. If this happens, this will also give some boost to the spur in economic growth. Second thing is our other sectors which are job-oriented sectors, we'll have to give push there also. And ease of doing business is one of them, that there is no alternative for that. We cannot work without it, because this is the one which is causing this cost. Being 130th on the ranking in the world is not a good place to be there in, and then expect growth. This is working as a bottleneck. So once we are able to do something about it, we are able to focus on this and we are able to find solutions to bring it, improve it, then we can see this will automatically spur the growth of economic activity in the country, because more efficiency will be added to our business. So these things and labor laws, for example, are also very, very necessary to bring that ecosystem which will take us ahead.
Sure.
So focus should be more on them to ensure that we are competitive from the world angle, and then things automatically flow when you are competitive. If I'm not competitive, the survival itself is very difficult or not possible. But if I am competitive, then there is nothing to worry about and you can always do better.
Sure.
This is my idea of the thing.
Sure, yeah.
Frank, I think we must understand here. He's a commerce and industry manager. And commerce, we have something like 70-odd FTAs, which the last minister said that will be reviewed. And they've not been reviewed till now. There are big bilateral and multilateral trade agreements which are coming up and which the new minister has to address. All these things are coming up in a time that by the end of this year, you know, he'll be attending a WTO meeting also, which will be where again he'll have to press upon the fact that services needs to be incorporated in every agreement, so to say. We have lost in the last 5 years or so, we have lost a lot of ground because of these FTAs. We were weak-kneed and spineless while negotiating them. We did not incorporate our requirements about movement of people. We did not take into account that what is the benefit that is accruing to the country. We are more interested in impressing upon another trade bloc that we could sign these agreement very quickly. But that is not the purpose of. There is supposed to be a negotiation. You need to understand that our biggest resources are manpower. Our biggest resources are engineering talent, and that talent is allowed to travel, work anywhere in the world.
Sure.
And we need to impress upon that in every agreement we sign.
All right. 2 minutes left on the program. Two quick closing comments from Mr. Desai as well as Mr. Dua. You know, Mr. Desai, several projects were started, Make in India, Startup India, then there's Invest India as well. You know, what has happened as far as some of these pet projects are concerned? Are we doing well? Should we continue on that trajectory?
Well, the startup thing certainly has improved over the past few years, but it doesn't generate the jobs at the rate at which is required. Two things I would say here. One is the macro factor. One key macro factor is the exchange rate, which is certainly hurting the exporter right now. You go to Chadar Bazaar, 90% of the goods there are manufactured in China. And many of them can easily be manufactured in India. And one of the reasons for that is we have today appreciated vis-a-vis the yuan also, not just generally.
Yeah.
Second, I'd be a little more cautious about revival of growth, because the impact of the monsoon in southern India and Deccan generally has been quite adverse. Sowings are very low, and I think the agricultural numbers that will come out after the Kharif harvest will not be very attractive for demand growth and so on.
Mr. Dua, quick closing comment from you.
Let me say, I would say in the months to come, let's look at the sectors which can take off without much of extra effort. Automobiles, I would put as the highest grading from my side, passenger car, vehicles, two-wheelers, all those kinds of things. Second, the railways, the dedicated freight corridors, which are about to be completed, for which money is not an issue since we are getting most of it from external, those would have a lot of forward and backward linkages as well as serve the industry. And finally, I would say with the GST launched, the area to concentrate now is to improve our logistics sector, because our competitiveness globally has been adversely affected hitherto because of our very high costs of moving the, right. The transaction costs were heavy because these elements, our systems of moving transportation wasn't there. If we attend to these, I think in the short run, we would see impact of it. Though in the medium and long term, many of the issues which we have discussed would also need to be addressed.
All right. On that note, then we'll have to call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Ajay Dua, Nitin Desai, SK General, Yatish Rajawat, thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. That's all the time we have today. See you again next time.